those of us placed in the position of a leadership must be prepared to grasp the nettle if we unite in doing so. And if in addition, we set a world example and a mark on pace and probity, on selfishness and self-sacrifice, the people will follow all too readily in our footsteps. Late Chief Obafemi Awolowo, a Nigerian nationalist leader. FUNAB, arguably the best of the specialized universities of agriculture in Nigeria, was established by the federal government in January 1988. But this has not been without its ups and downs. Coming from a few years in the doldrums, the current leadership of the institution, Professor Felix Kolawole Salako, has since November 2017 been saddled with how to reposition, re-engineer, and refocus this citadel of learning towards the fulfillment of its core mandate. Building on the legacies of the past captains of the ship of the university, Professor Salako has recorded quickly a number of turnarounds in the goals of teaching, research, and extension, the core mandate of FUNAB. Helpful in this task of restoration has been the background or the pedigree of this man behind the wheel of FUNAB's choice vehicle.
I think leadership is about experience too. When some people say that anybody can be a leader, anybody can be a leader to any particular age, I think they miss it. I've seen young people taking up even the position of presidents or prime ministers in Europe. But go and check the background of those people. They will have worked in the background with the party structure, political party structure. They will have been mentored by some people. Take the case of Macron. This university, I started as an administrator in 2001, when I was appointed the acting head of department. That was a responsibility in terms of administering at the very low unit of the university. I've been a director of a center for 3 years, and I've been the pioneer director of another center before I became Deputy Vice Chancellor on 2 terms. And that also led me back to the point where I became the Vice Chancellor. I don't think that is something that you can wish away. But I must also tell you something. I realized with time that because I read well, certain things come naturally to me without realizing that they must have come from the books that I read. I read a lot of books on humanities, a lot of books on social sciences, contemporary books, and I read autobiographies of great leaders.
An administrator itching to make a mark in these onerous tasks has, within the space of time of occupying the vice chancellorship seat, stamped his intention of joining the pack of VCs of the university whose footholds will not be easily erased or ignored with visible and meaningful results to showcase. Projects have indirect impact on its core mandate in relation to both academic and non-academic matters either completed or ongoing litter the landscape of the university campus. Such projects, no doubt, are adding value to the ambience of the institution. But the backdrop of walking is talk, implementation and execution of projects were not given to sentiments, but on needs. The administration believes the university is an ongoing concern, and therefore no room for abandonment of projects left by past vice chancellors. A peep into such projects or various execution of projects funded through the following sources. With due diligence and effective monitoring, the university is the better for it.
You can't divert it from money, but you may not access it if you don't meet the conditions given by TECON. They won't give it to you. So the issue of diversion of TECON money is not there. And TECON, that's monitoring and evaluation unit. They come to check, even for the ones that were spent. If you have not been able to access the money, what are they going to monitor? The money is with them. So the issue of diversion of the money is not there. You can only access it when you fulfill the conditions given. And as I said, it takes a lot of commitment to get that done. It takes a lot of being restless to get that done. The projects you are seeing are not just TECON projects. There are other funding agencies involved. The needs assessment projects are there. The capital funds from through the Federal Ministry of Agriculture are there. Some internally generated funds are there. And there are two projects funded by NHIS, partly. It's part funding, not really full funding. So different sources of funding are responsible for what we are seeing on ground now.
One major area where it can be seen visibly that the administration has done well is in the area of budget execution. Project execution and budget execution. What do I mean by project execution? When we came in initially, there were challenges with some projects, and there were issues of the university not being able to spend some of the fund available. But as soon as he came in, things had to move. Particularly in the area of third fund projects, the outstanding grant which were not spent before we came and which had remained unspent for some time, we have quickly administered the projects awarded, the processes gone through to enable projects awarded, and as I talk with you today, the funds are almost completely utilized. That's a pointer to the ability to make use of resources. The same thing goes with third fund projects. If you go around this university, you will be seeing what's going on. From the gate there to the back there, there are projects all over. And these projects, one the beauty about these projects is that they were projects that were started not too long ago. They are started and the speed of the execution is remarkable.
The newly completed academic building executed under the Needs Assessment Fund, the newly completed library complex, extension of the Senate building, the newly completed College of Engineering building complex, completed road construction of the Staff School, Phoenix, and the rehabilitation of the Alabata Phoenix Road, as well as the Alabata Harmony Abeokuta Highway, useful to both the university staff and the various communities in the area. A part of these various projects. Given this development, what impact has this been for both academic and development of the institution? The Deputy Vice Chancellor, Academic, Professor Bolanle Akeredolu-Ali, and the Deputy Vice Chancellor, Development, Professor Clement Adeofun, comment.
Right now, we have equipment that will be deployed to use. As soon as we resume, looking at the current situation of things in the world, we all know now that the way things are, technology, internet, is going to be used to drive education, and we cannot be found wanting. Unfortunately, without even knowing that that is going to become the new norm, the university has purchased, through most of the grants that we have, things, equipment that we can use to have our online and also e-learning, teaching and learning with the students. Apart from that, many of our lecturers have been winning laudable grants, and this is also contributing to the developments of our research, of our teaching, and also of our learning. A number of these grants are internationally driven grants. So that means we have collaboration. For example, I know we just concluded the CAVA project. I know we won, the university some years back won the Center of Excellence, which was a World Bank grant program. And we're moving. There are a number of, participated. The veterinary medicine, one of the lecturers in veterinary medicine just had a program from the grant he got, which was stepped down to our laboratory assistants and technologists in the university. So in terms of having collaborations with outside world, the university is pulling its weight. Well, I think the one that is most obvious is having the kind of environment that makes learning possible.
This university was established with a tripodal mandate of teaching, research, and extension. And I think it would be good to measure or assess the contribution or the achievement of the Vice Chancellor vis-a-vis these three lines of tripodal mandate of the university. In the area of course, teaching, the coming of this Vice Chancellor, more staff in terms of academic staff have been recruited. And not only recruited, more staff have benefited in terms of manpower development and training. A lot of our staff now have opportunity of traveling abroad for further studies. Those who have also, or some other people have also been privileged to acquire more knowledge in their various areas of specialization. And of course, these have tripled down to increase the knowledge base in terms of the area of teaching. In terms of research, of course, during this period, a lot of research grants have been won. Staff, because of his proactiveness, TED Fund and NIST assessment have also been able to support the research endeavors in these universities to the tunes of millions. And in terms of extension, of course, the Vice Chancellor, I think, have done credibly well in this area. And perhaps this is because he was a former director of AMREC, which is the research development arm of the university, and he's also the pioneer director of COFAPS, which is our community-based farming scheme, and which is an area that the university have really made a lot of impact, you know, on our neighboring communities or communities which we have relationship with in terms of actually teaching our students in the practical areas of agriculture. The one that you cannot see, human capacity development, just as I've said, which is basic. Whether you're talking about university, it's supposed to be knowledge driven. And this is essentially what university is meant for. And also one other area that at least during this tenure, we have a staff that have made giant strides worldwide in the area of international grants, in the area of FLIA award. That's the first time we have one of our staff having a FLIA award during this tenure, and I think it's a major, I think it's a major achievement.
However, there are striking executed projects which have become beacons of local, national, and international attractions in the ongoing repositioning of FUNAB in the last 3 years. Indeed, both now and in the future, these projects are significant selling points of the rising glory of the Federal University of Agriculture, Abeokuta. The Center of Excellence in Agricultural Development and Sustainable Environment, CADIS, is a pride to FUNAB. Bankrolled by the World Bank, CADIS is a regional center for Africa to bridge the gap of infrastructure deficits, encourage university-industry linkages and quality assurance. It is a cutting-edge center for the conduct of postgraduate research with ease. Professor Kayode Akinyemi is the director of the center. He explains the litmus test FUNAB passed through to have this center and the service it renders.
This place was established precisely in 2015. And this was after the Senate approval, because some other procedures had to be followed right from the time the grant was announced to the time we bidded for it, because it was a competitive grant announced by the World Bank. And then Federal University of Agriculture, Abeokuta, also bidded for the grant, amongst all other universities in Nigeria, in West Africa, in Central Africa. So the procedure for bidding actually lasted for like 1 year thereabout, because we have to assess, apply for the grant, and then we went through the first stage and the second stage and the third stage. And then fourth stage, that was a physical visit of the World Bank experts from the US and other experts. They came in here. We had face-to-face interactions with them. They also checked on some of the facilities we had. And then it was more or less like a roundtable talk. And that was the final stage. Then we were waiting for the announcement. Unfortunately, FUNAB won the grant. That was on the side of the World Bank. Now on the side of the university, because the Senate is the final approving center for the university, so the Senate also had to approve it. And so finally we took off in 2015. Actually, World Bank, as we know it, was not known to be funding university education before 2015. And this has been a challenge. It's been the major issue we have been having with the World Bank. World Bank was funding primary education, of course, due to reasons best known to them. Okay. But we put pressures on them at the level of the African Union, at the level of the individual countries and all of that. But thank God they heeded to our call, and then they started to think of how to fund university education. And of course, some reasons were identified as to why they must intervene at the level of the universities. One of the reasons, I'll tell you some of the reasons. The first one was infrastructural deficit. World Bank realized that because there was a needs assessment that was carried out in all the universities in Africa, and then they discovered, number one, infrastructural deficit. Of course, we all know what that means. And then also discovered there was a problem of regionalization. By regionalization, I mean students and faculty from within the region are no longer residing in Africa. For example, if you come to a university in Nigeria, you discover that hardly will you see anybody from West Africa as a student or as a faculty. So World Bank saw that as a major problem, why they must intervene in university education. The third one was university industry linkages. That was also a major issue. And I'm sure you understand that no university, no nation can make progress if this issue of university industry linkages is not addressed very frontally. So those were the three things they saw. And of course, let me quickly add one more. World Bank also identified a problem of quality assurance at the level of international accreditation. Before now, universities were carrying out national accreditation For us in Nigeria, we have a National Universities Commission that is saddled with our responsibility of going around all the universities, private, state and federal owned universities, and then trying to carry out national accreditation. But World Bank felt that we should do much more by also exposing ourselves to the international communities, bringing in experts from outside the country to come and check up what we have so that we can also compete, not just nationally, but internationally. So all of these issues were identified as the reasons why they must intervene. Ever since we got the grants and we started to implement the grants, of course, these four issues, I can say, to a very large extent, we have addressed all of them. So between then and now, we have been able to key into the objectives of the World Bank, setting up Africa centers of excellence all over Africa. Starting with the infrastructural deficit, before now, we didn't used to have very massive structures that we have been able to put up now as a result of the World Bank funding. By massive structures, I'm talking about some of the things you have seen here, and I will start most importantly about the issue of laboratories. In this place now, we have three standard laboratories, and these are not just ordinary laboratories, they are laboratories that house very standard cutting-edge equipment that you can use for postgraduate research. So we call them advanced laboratories, and of course, all of these things as a result of the World Bank funding. So what it simply means is that instead of as a postgraduate student coming for your master's and PhD here, and then you do some of your analysis here, and the ones you cannot do, we send them to South Africa, send them to Germany, send them to United States, and now we can conveniently say that most of those analysis, we can run them here. Not just for our own students and staff in the university, but some other staff and students coming from outside the university can make use of these laboratories. And they also, power used to be a very serious issue. And it is a very serious issue in Nigeria and some other parts of the world. But I tell you here now, to a very large extent, now we can say we are independent of some of these challenges. Because we have, through the support of the World Bank, we have our generators. Not only generators, we also have solar inverters that cover virtually all our activities in this place, and not just in this place, even for the students. Students can stay in their hostels, and then because we have also covered some of these hostels with solar inverters, which means that power is also not a major issue. Internet has been a major issue for some time now, and so all of these infrastructures we have been able to put together, because you can't run a university without having all of these facilities put together. And what it simply means is that you can come in here, do your research as a student, get all your facilities, get all your things done in one fell swoop, and I think that's the most important thing. And then also you can stay in a very good comfortable accommodation, stay in a very good comfortable hostel facility, have the best of the best equipment for your services and all of that. And so in terms of infrastructural deficit, we have been able to address that. Before now, I told you about national accreditation. And we have been having national accreditation, and also at the postgraduate level, because this is Africa Center of Excellence in Agricultural Development. We run only postgraduate courses, not undergraduate courses. So in all of these areas, we are on postgraduate programs, masters and PhD. And for the very first time, National Universities Commission started national accreditation for postgraduate courses using the Africa Centers of Excellence. This Africa Center of Excellence you have here in Funaab is just like one of the 10 we have in the entire nation. So they used the platform of the Africa Centers of Excellence to kickstart the national accreditation for postgraduate programs. Before now, they were only running for undergraduate programs. And so we were the guinea pigs, and then we started with it, and it went very fine. All our programs here, about 6 of them, in fact about 12 of them, because you have 6 masters and 6 PhDs. The minimum we had for our national accreditation was like 80. In fact, some of our programs had like 90%, 95%, and on like that. And as soon as we did that, then we now went forward to expose ourselves for international accreditation. Before now, no university in Nigeria had the experience of international accreditation. In our center of excellence, we have students from Liberia, from Togo, from Sierra Leone, from Gambia, and then from Benin Republic, and they are here, both males and females. But some of them have graduated, not just coming to study masters and PhDs, they have graduated and they have gone back to hold very sensitive and strategic positions in their countries. There's one of the graduates from Liberia now, and Gambia, precisely from Gambia, is now heading the agricultural directorate in the whole of the Gambia.
Professor Salako adds more on CADIS.
CADIS Laboratory. Honestly, I'm excited that it came, we succeeded in doing that. Because if you check my vision and mission, I talked about having a central laboratory. Why? Because you can easily manage resources, or you manage resources more effectively when you centralize. An equipment may be useful to about 5-10 departments in science, in agriculture, in environmental management. If you have them in 10 places, it means that you have to provide electricity 10 times, provide human resources 10 times, provide some other things 10 times. If you have that equipment in a central place, everybody, it's not every day that everybody will use it. So you can, when you have it in a place, you can effectively and efficiently manage the resources of the university. It's not every day that you need to use this particular equipment, and it's not everybody that will need to use it all the time. So if you have it in one place, resources can be channeled to that place, and it can be used effectively. That's why I'm very, very happy that we have that central laboratory.
Much as more facilities are being provided, needed inputs to put such facilities on campus in proper places are equally considered, as empty buildings devoid of essential provision of necessary inputs are useless to the delivery of quality academic service. Recognizing the importance of the library to acquisition of knowledge and skills, the university library was recently stocked with new volumes of books, while the unit has stepped up its services to be in tune with the reality of the times by deploying e-library resources to advance the course of learning at the institution. The university librarian, Dr. Mrs. Feintola Onifade, sheds more light.
Within these 3 years, the library has been able to step on. Because we have an added number of volumes of books running to hundreds, and they are current. They're not outdated books. And apart from that, we have 10 college libraries that are functional. And the impact of that college library is that we will make our library services to be nearer to the users, so that they will be able to have access to library services. And presently, we are subscribed to almost 6 e-resources. So our users, I mean our students and both the lecturers, still have access to the e-resources. So for postgraduate students and for staff who want to write up their research, and they want the cool pace of selling things to do it, so they can learn out these rooms. Each row contains 12 rooms, making 24. This is the e-library session where the student can come and use the computer. They can use it to search for academic purposes.
In the quest to fulfill the objectives of an institution meant for teaching and research, Funaab's Veterinary Hospital is fast becoming another treasure of added value to the university, with 17 out of our 23 products employed by the previous administration in Ogun State. an indication that the university was meeting the needs of our immediate community. With sound teaching and exposure to practical training, the present administration led by Professor Salako had gone further through TET fund provision of over 250 million naira, procured equipment that would further raise the bar of the teaching hospital to world class. In addition to seeking to be a center for animal disease diagnosis, there had been procurement of a digital X-ray machine to assist in teaching veterinary students, incubators, ongoing construction of a facility for quarantine of large animals, apart from diagnostic veterinary microbiology laboratory, virology, hematology laboratory, small animal surgery unit, and boarding facilities, among others. Dr. Kayode Shonibare is the head of the Veterinary Teaching Hospital and sheds more light on the state of preparedness of the hospital for teaching and research, as well as the quarantine holding yard under construction, and it is meant to keep at least 50 cows for grazing for 30 days.
The Federal Minister of Agriculture and Natural Resources have been very magnanimous because they see what is on ground, the equipment, the use of equipment, and they are now thinking of maybe within the next few months making the reference center for disease diagnosis in animals because of the facilities that we have, especially definitive diagnosis. So people won't have to go to the National Veterinary Research Institute to do diagnosis. Maybe the thing will be done here. Most likely FAO will supply some reagents that we're using for the running of some of these equipment if they come and they see the equipment on ground, especially those equipment for diagnosis. This place was opened in 2013-14, and it was not equipped, just the building. Boys, the administration of Professor F.K. Salako that really took up the challenge that how can a building be here with all the laboratories, and he said go and budget for equipment that will serve as diagnosis in the veterinary teaching hospital. And it was done. We sent in all the quotations, we sent in the details, and it was almost 250 million naira worth of equipment. And these are world standard equipment. That this place will definitely be a reference laboratory for disease diagnosis in southwestern Nigeria with the load of equipment that we're cutting right now.
In teaching veterinary medicine, there are standard rules.